ओके थैंक यू। ओके सो गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, और गुड मॉर्निंग और गुड आफ्टरनून वेर एवर यू आर जियोग्राफिकली लोकेटेड। सो आई एम तुषार एंड टुडे आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट टू साइंटिस्ट एंड व्हाट आर देयर थॉट्स ऑन, और अदर व्हाट वर देयर थॉट्स ऑन स्पिरिचुअलिटी। So considering the audience, I have kept it very simple and I will just try to introduce that how even scientists, which the general public considers as very rational and generally not so much inclined towards spirituality, can still have very profound thoughts when it comes to spirituality. So without wasting any time, I will just begin my talk. So I will talk about two scientists whom we all know in some or the other way. Sequentially, I'll first talk about their work, which is more known to us or which may sound more interesting, and then I will give a brief idea as to what their thoughts were as far as spirituality is concerned. So these the as I mentioned in the title, as Shravan also mentioned, it is a tale. So I will be talking about two stories. So without wasting it, I will just start with the first story. Around 100 years back, around 1914, there were two gentlemen who were riding in a cab in London, and they were having a normal chat. And suddenly, one of the gentlemen saw a car passing by. The car number was 1729. So one gentleman asked and just said as a statement, you know, two people are chatting in a cab. They said, "This is such a boring number," the first person said. To which second person responded, "Oh, is it? I find this number to be one of the most amusing number I have come across." Hearing this, the first person was surprised, and he said, "How come?" To which he answered, "This number is the smallest prime number that can be expressed as a summation of two different cubes in two different ways." And how is that? I have just put it up on the screen that this number 1729 can be expressed as summation of two different summation of two different set of cubes, cube. That is 9 cube plus 10 cube. So I think most of you would now recognize who this person is and who the person who was asking was. I'm referring to here. So you are correct. G.H. Hardy and Srinivasan Ramanujan. And the number that you just saw on the screen and the number which was on the taxi number plate is also now known as Hardy Ramanujan number. So there was one interesting thing that many of you might have missed out something, that he didn't need any kind of calculator or anything just to come up with the notion that this number is unique in this particular way. It just took some kind of, or what we in common terms call it as intuition. So just with an intuition, it just came naturally to him. Oh, how can that number be boring? It's very interesting in the way that it can be expressed as summation of two different cubes, and it is the smallest of the numbers of that class. So the first scientist, as you guessed correctly now, is Srinivasan Ramanujan, one of the greatest mathematician our country and this world has ever seen. So what so Ramanujan, just a small biography I will give. He was born in Erode, a small town, Tamil Nadu. During his adulthood, I mean his entire lifespan was only around 32 years. So whatever time he could spend as an adulthood was partly divided as a government clerk, and then the later years of his life he spent at Cambridge with Professor G.H. Hardy, a very renowned mathematician. One interesting point to note here was that he had no formal education in mathematics. Because of health conditions or because of financial condition, he had to leave his education. He enrolled in colleges, but he had to come out of it. So whatever mathematical identities or infinite sum series, which is for which he is very famous for, just came out as an intuition. Like it just came out of his mind whenever he used to attend any kind of work during his job as a government clerk. He used to write in his past time those kind of infinite sums and identities. And one particular gentleman noticed that, and he shared the identities and equations that he invented, rather I would say, to higher up authorities. And then they made a contact with Professor J.H.R.D. and that's how he went to Cambridge. So having said about this biography, one very interesting question that comes to everyone's mind, then how he was able to come up with such profound mathematical equations. The number which I showed in the previous slide was just one of the many intuitive thoughts that he had during his short but very intense lifespan. His work on infinite sum has now been found to be very useful in string theory and even as diverse field as string theory and even digital signal processing. For those of you who are not from the science background, string theory is considered to be the unifying theory or theory of everything in the universe, and digital signal processing forms the bedrock of whatever mobile communication we are having. It's a very important part of it. So that's such a profound thing. So how did he come up with that? And that's where lies his approach or his thought process to spirituality. So what was his connect with spirituality? His connect with spirituality stemmed from a very strong, very innate faith in the religious beliefs that he had. In fact, he went on to say that an equation for him doesn't have any meaning unless it expresses a thought of God. Especially when he refers to God here, he refers to his worshipping deity, which is Namagiri Tayar and Narasimha, the goddess of Namakkal, and apparently this is the goddess of creativity and wealth. So according to him and his experiences that he shared with his colleagues at Cambridge, one of them was very famous statistician and went on to become the chief statistician of India, Mahalanobish. He went on to discuss with him that like one of the infinite sum series, which he was very famous to know, well known for, just came as a dream to him. And wherein on a wall, it was just written to him and he just woke up and then he did the back calculation and proved that, oh, voila, it's actually the case. And that's how his approach to mathematics and spirituality was. Like for him, the numbers were not just numbers. They also expressed the innate faith that he had. And from his innate faith, again, he could have more intuitive ideas, which he expressed time and again, which even G.H. Hardy remarks in his letters of correspondence to other mathematicians. Another aspect of Ramanujan's spirituality was not just related to faith. Faith was just one aspect of spirituality. He also was profoundly thinking about the numbers and how they can connect with the question of oneself or the question of singleness in this universe. So this is very evident from the conversations that he had with his classmates, and even later on when he was working as a clerk, and he came across many mathematicians, like chief mathematicians of the Mathematical Society of India, Mr. Iyer. So all those people, when he used to discuss, at many such instances, he used to say that for me, zero as a number is not just a number. It actually does not have any kind of attribute. It does not have any quality. It doesn't have any negatives, it doesn't have any positive, which means it is absolute by itself. Similarly, infinite as a symbol, it's not just a symbol for him, or to express the series sum, or to express infinite geometric series, pardon me for the jargon, but it is not just about the symbol infinite. It is also about the number being able to express the totality of what all possibilities this universe had to offer. So for him, these were not just the numbers. These were they were just not just the number, but they were also something which was not related to faith. So this was something called as Nirguna aspect of his approach to spirituality. So as we can see here, there are two approaches that or two thoughts that Ramanujan had in mind. One was the Saguna approach, which was through the goddess Namakkal. And the second was Nirguna approach, which he found in numbers. So it's very interesting that how a person or a mathematician can find spirituality with numbers as common or as trite as zero and infinity. So this brings out a very different aspect that spirituality can be found in any place, and it can be found in numbers, it can be found in whatever you really are passionate about. One just has to seek and one just has to be curious about this finding of truth or finding of the knowledge, the sacred knowledge of finding oneself. So this journey can be irrespective of whatever field you are in, be it a scientist, be it an art or anything. So this Saguna approach of Ramanujan can, if I were to draw a parallel with a complete spiritual master, with a great spiritual master, could be Ramakrishna Paramahansa. For him, everything was Kali. Like even when his teacher Totapuri met him, even later on, like initially he tried to bring him and teach him the aspect of Nirguna approach or Advaita Vedantic approach. But even he really understood that even at the junction of Nirguna and Saguna, where Ramakrishna Paramahansa was really unique approach of spiritual learning. So that's where the first tale of the scientist ends. Now I would like to go to the second tale. Again, as I mentioned, both the tales are inspired by some stories. So here I will start another story. So there were two scientists, again, during that time. So I think that was a churning period of thoughts and ideas, which was early 20th century. And there was this gentleman, along with Sir Albert Einstein, who were having correspondence over letters. There were no mobile phones then, of course. So then they were talking about so many things, and one thing that really stuck out of those correspondence was one experiment, and how that experiment was unique, and how that led to a very profound thought about one of the most important discoveries of 20th century is what I'm going to talk about. So around 1920s or 1920, early 30s, Sir Albert Einstein and this gentleman just happened to meet at a conference, and the discussion that happened between them at the conference continued even after they left to their respective places. That discussion was on a particular experiment, and that experiment was not an experiment in its truest sense. Like during the last presentation by Pranav on science and spirituality, he specifically mentioned about experiments, that there is a curiosity and then there is a methodology and then there is experiment and then you verify that. But this was not experiment in that strict sense. It was a thought experiment. And how that thought experiment happened to be, and what was that thought experiment? That thought experiment was is described as follows. But before I describe this thought experiment in brief, I would like to put up a disclaimer that no animals were harmed in this experiment and no cats were killed. It's just a thought experiment. It was just discussion about what if this happens, what would happen. So as it was mentioned in the previous talk, for any experiment there is an experimental apparatus. So this was an experimental apparatus that. So this was an experimental apparatus. So the experimental apparatus said that there is a box which is tightly sealed, when there is no passage of air in and out. And in this blue box that you see over here, it is marked as radioactive, which means there is a radioactive material with a known decay period of 1 hour. And it is connected to some kind of relay, and which is strung to a weight. And just below the this weight, there is a container made of glass, and which is filled with a poison. which when and it is a sealed container of glass. So and there is a cat inside this. So the experiment goes as the following: if after 1 hour this particle, this radioactive particle, decays, then because of a weight counter, I won't go into the technical details further. As such, it is quite technical. But so, if this radioactive material decays in 1 hour, then this relay will be triggered, and the weight will be dropped onto this beaker, leading to the breakage of beaker and exposing the entire chamber to the poisonous gas over here, or which can eventually kill the cat. So there are two possibilities: either this particle will decay in 1 hour, or it may not decay in 1 hour, because there is always something called as experimental error. So what the thought behind this was, as so Schrodinger proposed as follows to Einstein, that look, if I am just about to open this container, the sealed container, within 1 hour, then this experiment is uncalled for, because I am breaking the I'm breaking the experimental condition. But just few fraction of seconds before I open the container, would I know if cat is dead or alive? Just before opening the container, then the correspondence started, and the idea that was presented after this correspondence was, just before opening this container, one would never know if cat was alive or dead, because just before opening the container, it might as well happen that the particle would have decayed, and the weight would have been dropped onto this glass container, and which would have exposed the cat to this poisonous cyanide. On the other hand, it would also have happened that the radioactive particle did not decay, and the cat would still be alive. So what does it mean here? To us, it would just mean that once I open the container, the best way to know is, once I open the container, I can see that the cat is dead or alive. But that would be a part of observation. If I am not observing it, what will happen is the point that Schrodinger was trying to drive home. And that's where his subject and object thought process came into his mind. And that's where his approach to spirituality began. In fact, after this experiment, it is said that he stopped, he almost stopped working on the physics-based problem, and he moved towards the problems in biology. So how did this experiment lead to the approach to spirituality for Schrodinger, and what was that approach is something I will be delving upon. So after that thought experiment, I would request you all to just have another thought experiment. This thought experiment is on having a candle. So as you can see on my screen, there is a candle lit, and the wick is burning, and there are different zones of flame. So even if I ask a kid who is in 9th standard or 10th standard, she will be able to say that, okay, the outermost zone is the hottest one, and the innermost zone, because of the unburned wax, it's the relatively cooler zone. But and apart from that, one can see that the wax is melting because of the increased temperature, and the wick is also burning by forming into some carbon compound. But what one may not think about is, when we are talking about these attributes, who is the observer here, or who is observing this? Is this going to be the same thing? Is the candle, if it was not burnt, is it going to be the same for an infinite amount of time? Is it going to be the same? So the idea that I'm trying to drive home here is, whenever we look at things, we only look at the object. We never look at the object from the observer perspective. We never consider the subject into the object. And that's where this duality of subject-object comes into the picture. And when we think more about it, that's where we start thinking about the existence of oneself, and that's how, as Ramana Maharshi says, the inquiry, the self-inquiry begins. Thinking about the observer, what is the observer? What exactly is the nature of the observer? Who is the observer? And these are the questions that will come to our mind naturally. So based upon this thought experiment, one can correlate the thoughts which were put up by Schrodinger. So there are many thoughts by Schrodinger given with referencing Upanishads and the scriptures written in Hindu philosophy. But these are the two thoughts which I really found with profound effect. The first thought it reads, read it out, the world is given to me only once, not one existing and one perceived. So we consider that the one existing and one perceived is different, but that's not the case. It's just one. The subject and object are only one. The barrier between them cannot be said to have broken down as a result of recent experience in the physical sense. For this barrier does not exist. So we say that the subject and object are different, but according to this oneness of this universe, this whole entire premise of Advaita Vedanta, it's all one. There is no barrier. And he continues that it is so simple that it is impossible to explain it, that there is no theory or postulate that you can put in, because we are so used to theories and postulates that if x plus y is equal to 1 and x and x minus y is equal to something, then x equal to this and y equal to this. We are so used to these equations. But this is so fundamental in nature, it is so simple that our mind is not trained in that way to just accept it as it is without any kind of proof. Because even we are the proof, like we, when I say the observer is the proof, the realization that we are the observer is the proof. So then this whole idea which I was referring to as equations or postulates, it really brings out in the next line. It cannot be grasped by the intellect, but it may spring up in you at some occasion like a spark, and then it is there and will never really leave you, even though it is not a practical maxim to use every hour of your life. So this, it may spring up, so this part of this statement, it may spring up in you at some occasion like a spark, is nothing but that moment of realization when you really are able to have that thought dawn upon you that, okay, that everything is just happening, and there is this oneness, there is no subject, object is totally dissolved here, like there is nothing but just one. And that's what is mentioned here, and that's when they say that that spark is the moment of realization. And that's what Schrodinger was referring to, that this approach to quantum mechanics, this dual behavior, the wave and particle behavior of quantum mechanics, really brings out the subject and object duality very clearly, which can not only be limited to very 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 small particles such as electrons or protons, but even microscopic objects. If you really think about it, if you really deep delve about these things on a frequent basis. So that's what Schrodinger's thoughts were on this particular aspect, and that's how his spiritual thoughts evolved as a function of the equations that he developed, which are now the bedrock of quantum mechanics. So that brings me to the end of this presentation or this talk. So as I was mentioning, I will just list out one of the important contributions of Sri Devasa Ramanujan, that is work on divergent infinite series. Very famous example. I think most of you, I would recommend to read about this further. It's very interesting and very non-intuitive. Like a sum of 1 minus 1 plus 1, it's called divergent series, is actually can be proven as 1 by 2, and how that is happening is very nicely explained, and Ramanujam just happened to have it. Similarly, he could identify that the sum of natural divergent numbers 1, 2, 3, 4 can be expressed as minus 1 by 12. So these kind of intuitive thoughts came just from his from his faith and from his approach to spirituality, and then he back calculated it, and then he came up with the entire proof, for which the formalism of which was helped definitely by Professor G. H. Gandhi. Similarly, the contributions of Erwin Schrodinger, he laid the foundations of the quantum theory that we read and study by arriving at the famous wave equation, and he was given Nobel Prize for this. So yeah, the conclusion for this particular talk and any take home message from this particular talk would be that one can find path to spirituality in anything. For example, Srinivasa Ramanujan could find it in equations, zeros and infinity. Whereas for Edmund Schrodinger, it was just a thought experiment and the wave equation and the dual nature, which was enough for him to go into that path. The need is, or the requirement is, just to be curious, open, and just to seek. And yeah, if you seek, you will get it. So with that, I will rest my case. Thanks everyone for your time, and I'm open to questions. Thank you.
Okay, it's short but very good talk, Tushar. Let's look at this, what you have just said, simple thoughts, but let's have some actions from some of the people in this, on what is the implication of what you spoke. Firstly, Prabhuji, how do you find this coming from a scientist?
Yeah, thank you, Tushar, for a wonderful talk. You brought out two personalities, Ramanujam and the other one is, who is, what's his name?
Schrodinger.
And Schrodinger cat experiment was a very nice experiment, way of explaining things, that when there is no observer, you don't know, that the world may not be existing. So my question to you, if there's no observer, is there a world?
Yeah, I mean, that's what, then in that case, if there is no observer, there is, for all practical purposes, it is there. But if we consider oneness, then there is no world.
you mean to say you subscribe to the way view that the world is there if the observer is not observing?
Yeah, till I reach, I understand that thought profoundly, I think I will subscribe to that.
Okay. World cannot exist without the observer.
Yeah, I mean, till the point I understand the integrities, I think I would like to subscribe to that.
And
the
world is there moment to moment, or is it there created one time, Big Bang?
I think the world is ever changing. I think world is ever changing.
Ever changing? So it is ever changing, or it is moment to moment, appears and disappears?
Yeah, appearance and disappearance is also a kind of change.
Okay. So the question, like, here is, there is a theory of Big Bang where world was created at some point of time.
Right.
Nobody has seen that Big Bang because there's no observer at that point of time.
Right.
Okay. There's only hypothesis.
Right.
But for me, as an observer, the world appears and I observe.
Right.
So which of this is true?
Which of this is, as in, if the Big Bang is true, or the world that I'm observing is true?
World that I'm observing is appearing now. This is the Big Bang.
I think if we consider from the hypothesis perspective, the Big Bang theory would be one of the possible explanations of how this universe came to be. But if we see the current universe, like, it's not possible for us to fathom the entirety of the universe. So we don't know if there is any other Big Bang happening at this moment or not. Like,
this is the moment of Big Bang when I observe something. The universe appears. Is it true? Okay. Thanks, Tushar, for a wonderful talk on these two scientists. Okay. Anybody else? Anybody has a question? Shravan?
So, Tushar, one question that I was thinking is, you mentioned that the approach of these two scientists, one was going by faith and the other person was going by inquiry. Ramanujam was knowing things by faith, and crucial, because even in spirituality, you know, we have two paths. One in which the Bhakti Marga and the Jnana Marga, right? One is an inquiry, another one is just a faith.
Right.
But I wanted to understand how faith will really lead to something in science first. Let's look at that. How inquiry, I've understood, we all know how scientific inquiry leads results. How faith leads.
So if I have understood your question correctly, you are asking how faith can lead to any kind of scientific inquiry. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
Okay. So I think that's a very subjective thing to tell, but from whatever Ramanujan's life, we can understand, or we can think of, or what rather I could understand and I could imply, is that if like math was his passion, like even if he didn't have any kind of formal education, math was his passion, and he used to think about mathematical equations from whatever little exposure he had through libraries or through books that his friends used to share with him. The idea of faith just I would say corroborated his interests further. It just supported his passion further. So the first thing that he had was passion about mathematics. The faith, as far as Ramanujan was concerned, and his and my understanding of Ramanujan is concerned, limited understanding, I would only say that his faith only strengthened his approach or his interest or his passion towards mathematics. And I mean, constant thinking about that okay, I will be able to come up with this equation or this idea later on, even during his days at Cambridge. This faith was the one that was really helping him to sustain so many adversities, is what I would say.
Okay.
Shravan, regarding your question about faith.
Yes,
there is a faith. Faith is something which you don't know. Okay. About something which you believe that is true, but it's not. You don't know. Whereas in case of Ramanujan, he says the mathematical equations appear in his vision, where his deity Ishta Devata will come and show him the mathematical formulae, and he's intuitively seeing that divinity. It is like it's slightly more beyond faith which you are speaking of. He is speaking of a realization where he is realizing the faith is till you realize, but once you realize, it's not a faith, it's a reality. So Ramanujan was operating from a domain of not a faith, but a reality of Saguna Brahma or manifest reality.
Okay.
So was Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. When Ramakrishna Paramahamsa worshipped Kali, it is not about faith. He has gone beyond faith. He is experiencing Kali in the form. So the manifest reality is Kali. In that sense, it's no longer a faith. It is beyond faith. It's a realization of Saguna Brahma.
Okay. So is this by intuition and the illumination, or it is beyond the illumination where it is? My question is how progressing. So let's say a person in a scientist as well, or in any field, including spirituality, how does the one come to that stage where he operates from that state where you're saying Ramakrishna or Ramanujan is now operating?
See, when I will not be able to give exact answer, but I'll try to give what I understand. What happened is that our nervous system is designed for looking at the objective reality, objective world. It's the brain and nervous system which projects the outer world for us.
Okay.
So before the brain projects the outer world, the world is not there. It's a wave function. It's not a wave particle. The brain is the actuality or actual experience what we get. So now most of our brains are projecting a world which is solid, and a person who is evolved, whose mind is illuminated, whose brain is illuminated, he has entered into a higher level of mind where the projection is approximating the universal mind. So for which a level of purification of the mind and nervous system is required. That level of purification is what we call sadhana or spiritual practice. So the nervous system becomes silent, and the silent mind reflects the consciousness much more beautiful way. And that reflected consciousness in the silent mind, in a sattvic mind, gives the experience of Saguna Brahma or oneness of life. That's my understanding.
Yeah, wonderful, Prabhuji.
Yeah, I would just like to add to what Guruji said. Like, even if you look at the life stories of saints or even Ramakrishna Paramahansa, they... Hello? Yeah. Yeah, am I audible?
Yeah, go ahead.
So one thing that is common in these saints or even Ramakrishna Paramahansa is that the first step to the realization in their path was dissolving them completely. Like they did not have any identity of their own. For example, if we talk about Ramakrishna Paramahansa, as Guruji mentioned, it was only Kali. Like, for him, everything was Kali. He himself, like, everything for him was Kali. Similarly, for saint like Tukarama, everything for him was Vitthala. Nothing else but Vitthala. So the first step is to lose your identity. When the identity loses, the path becomes clearer, is what I understood from the life stories from Alimut.
Perfect. That's where the saints and including our Ramanujam, they surrender completely to the deity. There's no individuality left. And for me, that means actually the nervous system is, there's no ego representation in the nervous system, which causes noise. So the nervous system is noise free. And that noise-free system, you will realize some experience. That experience is what we call divinity.
Fantastic. Very good, Prabhuji. Okay. Shall we ask some of the participants if they have any questions to Tushar? Or even to Guruji, if you want to look at the spiritual angle. So the other one, if I can ask, subject and object, only recently in science we are looking at the subject or the observer, things like that, correct? And in each experiment, observation done by the is being guessed right now. Earlier, all the experiments were, independent of the observer. Only now we are looking at the importance of the observation coming in. But can we say that what Schrödinger has now, concluded, that there is no distinction between observer and observed? This is close to be proved in science, or is it just a perception right now, Tushar?
From what I've understood, this is more of an experience that a person can have. Like, it cannot be proven for everyone, like a law or like a rule or even like an axiom. This is something one has to experience, and only then one will be able to subscribe to this understanding or this thought process.
Okay.
There cannot be any experiment to from at least now. I'm not sure if later on, maybe 100 years, maybe later years, it can change. But as of now, it's very subjective. Like, only one after experiencing, one can say that, okay, yeah, that's how it works. That's how it is. like there cannot be any law that okay if you do in this way or any statement of verb or SOW in which if you follow you can achieve that.
Okay, Prabhuji, your reactions on that? Sorry, you are muted, Prabhuji.
I lost your question because my voice was muted. Can you audio was gone? Can you tell me question?
So my question was this observation. Schrodinger has said that in reality there is no subject and object.
Correct.
My question was whether science is close to understanding or even proving in some way that there is a continuity of subject and object. There's one unity there. So for which Tushar said, no, it's still a perception. There's no axiom or there's no way or method or SOP for reaching to it even at the moment for the science, in science. Now, I want to ask you, in spirituality, how is it? How can we conclude that the subject and object are in reality are one for the benefit of all what we are looking at?
Okay.
And where science should grow to get to that point?
Yeah. The understanding the subject and object are one reality is through a Vedantic process or a prakriya, which is actually looking at the reality of objects, understanding the objects are but nothing but name and form, and seeking the subject, which is the witness, then realizing that oneness of the witness and witnessed is the way method of Vedanta. It's called prakriya. It's a systematic process by which you come to a clarity and understanding that there's only one reality, subject and object are one. So Vedanta has a systematic prakriya or process for that. In Tushar's language, what is it? SOP, right? Steps. So Vedanta has a definite steps by which you start understanding the objective world is not, it's just a name and form appearance. Neti, neti, neti. With that process, you reach a subject, pure subject. Then you recognize that existence in all aspects of creation called Brahman. Then you realize that subject and object are one reality and everything is just appearing and disappearing. It's not real. It's a systematic process by which we can do that. Is that answering your question?
Yes, good. Any more questions from participants? There was a question, of course, from in the chat as who was besides Einstein, and I think that was Schrodinger, right? The picture that you have shown, you probably have not shown with the name again.
But... Yeah, yeah.
Okay, good. Okay, so any more questions, anybody? Pranav?
There is one hand raised by Mr. Chandrasekhar. I'm not sure if the question is to go.
Yeah, Chandrasekhar, can
there
you...
is a hand raised by...
Yeah.
Uncle, I got the answer, Uncle.
Oh, you got the answer. Okay.
Okay. I'm glad. Thank you.
I'm family ready. I study.
Sorry, you are not audible.
I am family ready. I study in class 4.
Oh, okay. Okay. And what's your question?
I think, Shravan, the question was related to the person who was next to the Einstein.
Oh, okay. Same thing. Very good. Okay. Any other questions, please? Or even Pranav, any comments that you want to?
No, I mean, that's good.
Okay. Prabhuji?
Yeah, I mean, many of these are the saguna relations are very experiential. There was on Apollo 14 mission, one person called Michel was there. He was sitting in the lunar module and he went through a profound transformation of samadhi, experience of oneness. After coming back from the Apollo mission on the moon, he founded an organization for research into consciousness, spent the rest of his life in consciousness research, where he experienced oneness in the moon.
Oh, okay. So, Tushar, one of the other things that I was really looking at is this, of course, started the subject-object debate, but there are some scientists now who say, actually, there is no reality at all. It's all in what they call the action. Based on that, the reality appears in multiple ways. There is no one given world, but the world depends on the observer or the agent of action or whatever. You must have heard this line of thoughts, where for each one observer, there's actually a different world. And depending upon the certain criteria, it becomes a common world. So do you have any light on us for that process of thinking?
Like as Guruji said, as we we blink our eyes every time, the Big Bang is happening. That could be one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at it could be this can be another experiment. Like we can have two people going through the same schedule in an entire day, 24 hours, for example. Okay, not 24 hours, maybe 14, 15. And then when they go to sleep and when we observe their REM cycles, sleep cycles, it will be different for them. But during the sleep, the reality for them is the actual reality that they are witnessing. However, they are entirely different if we see the REM cycles or if we analyze the REM cycles. Despite the fact that they were given the same conditions and same stimulus during the day in form of food or in form of experience or in form of visuals. So that can be another way of actually looking at it. I'm not very sure if this is a definitive answer, but yeah, this can be one of the examples where there can be two worlds that can exist based on the observation and based on how we perceive things.
Okay. Prabhuji,
does that answer?
I understand. So that's fair enough. But Prabhuji, what is the reality? Do you think is it possible that depending upon the state of consciousness, the world changes? Or
actually, the mind, what you see, what you observe is the interpretation happening in the mind. World is nothing but the mind. So your mind, my mind, Tushar's mind, every day we have different minds. The quality of the mind, content of the mind is different. In that sense, each of us are experiencing different worlds. For example, there is a story in Buddhism. Three beings go to a riverbed. One is a demon. He says, the river is nothing but blood and urine. And one being is a human being. He sees the river as a source of irrigation. And one being is a devata. He sees that is a place of enjoyment. The same objective reality is different for each of the subjects. So there is no, in the sense, we have multiple worlds operating in each of our head.
Okay. Very good. Interesting. Okay. So that's good enough. I think we are close to this.
There's one common objective.
Sorry, Prabhuji. Go ahead.
Yeah. Let us conclude the session. Okay.
Yeah.
The objective reality, what we call, is nothing but subjective reality, and subjective reality varies from person to person.
Okay. So that's good. Any more questions before we can conclude the talk? But if there are no more questions, thanks, Tushar. It's very thought provoking. These simple thoughts will have lots of knowledge that we can get when we look at into it, both in science and in spirituality, because what we are looking at here is a method of looking at both science and spirituality, and the process in with which we look at them, how to derive the benefit of one from to the other domain. So thanks a lot, Tushar, for your talk, and thanks, Prabhuji, for your answers. And
thank you, Tushar, for wonderful thought-provoking tales.
Thanks.
Okay.
Thanks,
everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thanks.